Today we are going to discuss a totally different scenario or topic in which generally the patient is very much concerned, and approach to the swellings in the neck is always very tricky and needs total attention. So we are going to discuss or share our views about the common swellings which are generally seen in our general practice, and we will be very brief, and whatever is required from you people there in your clinics, we will stick ourselves to those areas only. We are not going to go into the details of everything, because otherwise it is a huge topic. Next. The objective which we have set for today's session are that by the end of this presentation, you should be able to recognize clearly the different swellings of the neck and treat simple, uncomplicated infectious swellings which make a bulk of, in fact, the swellings, those are seen in the neck. And you should be able to differentiate clearly between benign and malignant conditions. And after having some idea about the swelling, you should be able to initiate the investigation process. Then you can send the case to the ENT departments, and also you need to educate patients properly during the course of the treatment, as these patients are generally in touch with their family doctor. Next. So we begin with some very simple and main anatomical landmarks in the neck. And the main landmark and the most striking and the prominent feature is sternocleidomastoid muscle, and it forms basically divides actually this neck into triangles, which are anterior triangle and posterior triangle. Anterior lies anterior to sternomastoid and up to the midline. Next. The further subdivision of the anterior triangle is submandibular triangle here, submental this region, and carotid triangle somewhere here, in which carotid sheath is located, having very important structures like internal carotid artery, internal jugular vein, and many last four cranial nerves. Next. So this is the real picture showing you the sternocleido, very prominent sternocleidomastoid in this lady. And this, next, divides the region into two triangles, anterior triangle bounded medially by the midline and laterally by the sternomastoid, and then the area behind the sternomastoid is posterior triangle. And the structures which are present in the anterior triangle are very important structures, like trachea, esophagus as tubes, these are present. Thyroid is again a very important structure that is present, and major vessels and lymph nodes, lot of lymph nodes are present in anterior triangle. Next. And in the posterior triangle, as you can see, there are lymph nodes present and roots and trunks of brachial plexus are also there. These are the important structures. There are many other also, but we are not going into that detail. Next. Now we are going to see a different, just for your interest, basically I have placed these pictures before discussing any conditions. This is a patient presented in ENT department. As you can see, the lumps are there. These are, the skin overlying is little hyperemic, and the location generally is in the anterior triangle. And as we ask the patient to swallow, there is no movement. So what can it be? It can be a cystic swelling. If it is a cystic swelling, what you should consider may be a cystic hygroma, which is very unlikely by its look. Brachial cyst, again it is very unlikely because of its location and the area and the surface or the skin over it. So it most probably looks like a cold abscess, which is having no movements on swallowing. It is a cystic swelling and showing hyperemia over the skin. Next. Again, there is a big swelling in front of the neck in the anterior triangle, and it moves on swallowing. What can it be?
Thyroid.
Yes, very correct. It is a thyroid lump. Next. Now there again is a swelling right in front of, in the midline, in the neck, in the anterior triangle, and it also moves on protrusion of the tongue. And you people are very intelligent to name this. It moves on protrusion of the tongue. Yes, next. This is a thyroglossal cyst. Ji. Again, this child is being asked to protrude the tongue. Ji. Next. Next. Now, you can see this old lady having a big swelling in the submandibular area. It is a single solid lump. So, what is your comment about it? It is a little lateral in the submandibular triangle. Yes, it can be a lymph node in the submandibular region, but how can you differentiate between a lymph node in the submandibular region or a submandibular gland itself, a large submandibular gland? Gee, very nice. If you examine the patient properly by doing bimanual palpation, keeping one hand in the submandibular region outside and bringing your finger into the floor of the mouth, and you palpate. If you can palpate the swelling bimanually, it is submandibular gland. If you can palpate the swelling, if you cannot palpate that swelling bimanually, it is only palpable from outside, it is most likely a lymph node. So, yes, next. So this is a submandibular gland lump, and we will see how to reach to the diagnosis. This is not the only, this is just a show, slideshow of different conditions. Actually, we will discuss how to reach to the diagnosis. Next. Now this lady is showing multiple lumps in submandibular region. What would you think of? Lymph nodes. Yes. These are the lymph nodes. Next. Now, this is a single, or you can think of multiple lumps in submandibular, submental triangle, in fact. It actually, this is a picture taken at a very later stage. It must have started as a small swelling. It is a little difficult, but anyways, I will tell you. Yes, next. This is a dermoid cyst of this region, which is submental triangle. G, next. These are single, or this is a single lump in the submental triangle. This most probably would be a lymph node. Yes. Gigi, we will discuss the flow chart. We will discuss the flow chart. This will be very interesting for you, in fact. G, next. So, this is another lady, unfortunate lady, having multiple nodes in the posterior triangle which have caseated. In fact, this lady had these metastatic nodes in this region, and this is in advanced stage. Again, this is a single lump in the region which lies below the auricle. It has obliterated the angle of the jaw. What can you think of? Yes, very nice. This is a swelling which is arising from the tail of the parotid gland. Next. This is again a very advanced case of breast cancer, which has metastasized from here to supraclavicular region. So, supraclavicular region has its importance in examination. Next. Now, the key points in examination, or you can say catchment areas, where generally people don't concentrate, are in the oral cavity. Especially, we have a very common routine of just asking the patient to open the mouth, or usko ke tongue depressor dala, see the thak samne dekha, that's it. Ya mareez ko ek dafa, ek interesting baat hai, wo patient bahut der intezar karna pada usko outside the clinic, aur andar jab aayi khatoon to usko jab kaha ke muh khole, to kehti hai mera muh na khulwaye. She was very angry. Sometimes you have to listen to such things also. But during examination of the oral cavity, you must inspect the floor of the mouth. You must inspect the area which is called retromolar area, posterior to the last molar tooth. That is again very important area to be discussed, which may have something which can be, if diagnosed early, the prognosis may be better. Next. Look for lymph nodes elsewhere also. So that means an ENT examination does not conclude with the examination of just nose, throat and ears. It also includes the examination of neck, all the cranial nerves, and many times other systems also. Next. Now, there is a swelling somewhere here in the neck of this lady. Moves with most probably moves with swallowing. This is, and if you happen to examine this case, this swelling is not that mobile, and it is, the overlying skin is also not pinchable. So the skin is also attached with the swelling. It is most probably a thyroid tumor. And what about this one? There is a swelling in the neck. It can be a, yes, it can be a lymph node, but it seems more likely to be not thyroid. In fact, it also moves with protrusion of the tongue. Yeah, it can be a branchial cleft cyst also. Yeah, we will see how to reach to the diagnosis in the next slides. Again, this is a swelling which can be any one of these, but you need to have a proper history examination. And this is a dermoid cyst, because it is attached with the skin. Submandibular gland swelling, you can see here, and this is a view which is called orthopentomogram. This is called orthopentomogram, or asan ilfaz mein isko OPG bolte hain, and usually done by orthodontic people, dental surgeons. But this is very useful in ENT also, and you can see a mass somewhere in this region, which is submandibular glands region, and most probably there is a stone which is obstructing the duct of the submandibular gland, also called Worthen's duct, and the patient presents with a swelling in the neck like this. Next, again there is a swelling in the submandibular gland region, and you can see a stone. Next, it can be in the form of a stone, or it can be a cellulite. Cellulite is little different from a stone, because stone is a definite solid thing. This is a semi-solid thing, and just a, you can say sort of a semi-solid jelly type thick secretions are there. Next, again this man is showing swelling in the right side of the neck, and on x-ray this cellulite is visible. Next. Now this is a case showing huge mass in posterior triangle region, and most probably this is involvement of lymph nodes, many lymph nodes in some malignant disease, and it has presented like this. Next. In posterior triangle supraclavicular region, as we have already seen, it is very important, and this swelling in the supraclavicular region showing Virchow's nodes, which are very important, and these nodes are generally metastatic, and the mets comes from most probably the upper GIT, also upper limb and breast should be examined in such cases. Next. Other regions which are adjacent to the neck may have some swellings which protrude into the neck, and patient may present like this. like parotid lumps may appear in the neck. Next. Now, coming on to the diseases which generally present as neck swellings, and the working basically the idea and a flow chart in your mind should be like congenital swellings, developmental swellings, inflammatory swellings, neurogenic swellings. So there you can differentiate very easily between different conditions, and also if you also consider the site of the swelling, which we have already seen, you will be very comfortable in reaching a probable diagnosis. So what congenital conditions can present as neck swelling? Thyroglossal cyst, lymphangiomas, as we have seen, these can be tricky, these can be simple lymphangiomas, these can be cavernous, or the extreme is cystic hygroma. Dermoid cysts are inclusion cysts, these can present anywhere, but most probably these present in exactly in the midline. Parenchyal cysts and sinuses again are the remnants of the parenchyal apparatus. So these are the congenital conditions, and if you go into the history, you can very easily take a history of the patient and you can think of a congenital condition if the history dates back to the birth of the child. Developmental swellings are the swellings which develops later on in the life, but the problem was there at the beginning somehow. As laryngoceles are basically the sacs which develop in the remnant of the air sacs, which normally are present in birds and many animals, but generally in human beings these sacs disappear, but the remnants of these sacs may present as laryngoceles, which can be internal or external, we will see in the pictures. Pharyngeal pouch is again a congenital weakening in the posterior wall of the hypopharynx. Killian's dehiscence is the name given to that area, and these pouches can present in the neck as a swelling. Next. So here you can see a laryngocele. It presents as a swelling in on the side of the neck. It may disappear also. It may be, the patient would present you as having intermittent swelling in the neck. Intermittent means the swelling is sometimes present and sometimes it disappears. And if you happen to examine the case and ask the patient to do Valsalva maneuver, it will inflate and it will appear in the neck. And if you get her above the, your patient's x-ray done at that time, it will look like this. There would be an air sac in the neck. So the diagnosis is very clear and the treatment is surgical. Next. This again is a swelling on the side, lateral side of the neck in the anterior triangle. Guess what is this swelling? We have already seen this swelling. Next. This is a parenchyal cyst. Next. This is very clear. This is cystic hygroma. a child looks like a monster. And no one can miss the diagnosis. Next. Next. The picture is not very clear, but there is a swelling in this region. This is this. Yes, if it moves, but it is little above that level. It is in the submandibular region, most probably. Next. This is a dermoid cyst. Next. So, those were the congenital and developmental conditions, and now we come on to the infective conditions which can present as swellings in the neck. The infective conditions can be bacterial and viral, and in bacterial, acute infections include streptococcal, sore throat, can cause enlargement of a lymph node which is tender. There can be dental infection which can present as a swelling of the lymph node which is acutely inflamed. Diphtheria, very, very important diagnosis not to miss. It is a diagnosis which should never be missed. And in diphtheria, generally caused by Corynebacterium diphtheriae, and presents as a membrane in the oral cavity over the tonsils or anywhere in the pharynx. It may also present in the nose and larynx. But the very specific things about diphtheria are the patient, when you look at, is having temperature around 100 and 101, but the look of the patient is very toxic. He may be having a pulse of above 150, so relative tachycardia is there, as temperature is not that high, but the tachycardia is severe. And there would be bull's neck, lots of lymph nodes enlarged in the neck to such a level that it is termed as bull's neck. So this is also another cause of swelling in the neck. In chronic, the most common in our region is tuberculosis. Not very difficult to diagnose, and you people are, I think, in habit of diagnosing it. Yes, we have seen I have seen 4 or 5 cases. Of those 4 or 5, one was having really big neck, and all the neck was full of lymph nodes. But that actually, that is not the point. If you happen to see membrane over the tonsil, which is dirty, grayish, greenish, patient looks toxic, having respiratory difficulties, you should not think of anything other than diphtheria, and you should immediately respond to the situation, and you should immediately start with the treatment. Whatever you need to, of course, you need to give ADS, anti-diphtheric serum, immediately, because you want to neutralize whatever exotoxin is lying free circulating in the circulation. Because whatever is fixed, you just cannot do anything about that. You can just neutralize the toxin which is circulating free in the circulation. And you need to start with antibiotics. Simple antibiotics are good enough to cover the bacteria itself. In viral situations, infectious mononucleosis caused by mostly Epstein-Barr virus presents with multiple lymph nodes in the neck. If you If I go into the details of each disease, it would be a little difficult to close it in time. Anyways, infectious mononucleosis is again a condition which may present with multiple lymphadenopathies. Mumps, rubella, all these things can involve the lymph nodes in the neck. Next. Neurogenous tumors are there, they can also present in the neck as swellings, which may be paragangliomas and peripheral nerve tumors. Next. This is a tumor of the vagus nerve. It may present like this, as big as this much swelling in the neck. It is a very dangerous situation, in fact. Next. Now coming on, those were the benign conditions which does not cause much harm to the patient, but there are malignancies of the neck also, and generally these are very aggressive. And primary diseases which present as neck mass are from the thyroid, different carcinomas of the thyroid, papillary, follicular, medullary, and anaplastic. Salivary glands can also present in neck if they have malignancies, which generally are mucoepidermoid and adenoid cystic carcinomas. Next. Now, the most important part of this session, the approach to a patient with lump in the neck. How should we approach? A detailed, complete history of the patient is very important, and you just cannot ignore this thing, because history would tell you about, and you can differentiate many things from the history. As if the history dates from the birth of the child, it may be a congenital swelling. So you can think of a congenital thing. And age-wise, many conditions are prevalent age-wise. So you need to go into the details of history. Your examination, as I have already told you, that in examination, it is not just ENT. You need to examine whole of the head and neck and maybe other areas also. And then you can make a working diagnosis, and you can investigate according to your probable diagnosis and plan for the management. Next. In history, you have to lay emphasis on local symptoms of the head and neck, but also consider the symptoms of the other region. As if you find a swelling in the supraclavicular region, you need to take history of other systems also. Next. The local symptoms about the lump, you can ask whether it is painful or painless. Painful swellings are inflammatory swellings. Painless swellings may be anything other than inflammation. Site, as we have already seen, site of the swelling is very important, whether it is in the anterior triangle. Thyroglossal cyst cannot be in posterior triangle. If the swelling is in the anterior triangle, yes, you can think of thyroglossal, but in posterior triangle, you would be thinking of something different. Rate of growth is again important. If the rate of growth is very fast, you can most probably think of a malignant situation. And these symptoms again are very important: dysphagia, dyspnea, and hoarseness. These tell you about the problems which patient may be having, but those are not visible. And after complete examination of the patient, you may be able to reach up to the diagnosis. Next. These constitutional symptoms like fever and weight loss also indicate something very important. Next. The examination of the lump, as we have discussed time and again, the site of the lump, movement on swallowing, number is also very important, whether it is single or multiple, solid or cystic swellings. Mostly cystic swellings are not malignant. Solid lesions can be malignant in less number of patients. Fixed or mobile swellings, again, mobile swellings are less likely to be malignant than fixed ones. And the color of the overlying skin, if it is a normal looking skin, it won't be inflammatory in origin. In fact, the mass which is lying under that skin is probably not inflammatory. Next. So the palpable lymph node may indicate one or more of the following situations. The situation number one is acute inflammatory disease. Then the node should be in most of these are not 100% true, but in most cases these statements would be correct. If the node is smooth, firm, movable and tender, most probably it is because of acute inflammation. If the node is discrete, firm, movable and non-tender, sometimes matted also, the problem may be a chronic disease with fibrosis, like tuberculosis. If the node is non-tender, firm to hard and fixed, neoplasia is the probable diagnosis, and systemic diseases may present in the nodes which may be variably palpable and usually non-tender. Next. The examination again of lymphatics include cervical, axillary, epitrochlear and inguinal. And always during palpation use circular motion of the fingers or walk your finger over the area to be examined. Don't try to get something out of there. You just have to palpate with the pulp of the fingers. Don't use the tips use nahi karni aapne. If the lymph node is there, it will be palpable over the pulp. Next. Now we are going to have a flow chart of of such situations. After taking detailed history and examination, what situations arise. Next. The lump may be in the anterior triangle, lump may be in the posterior triangle. Next. If that lump is in the anterior triangle and it shows no movement and it is solid, it would be most probably a lymph node. If it is cystic, it can be branchial cyst, dermoid cyst, cystic hygroma, or if it shows pulsations, it can be carotid body tumor or some aneurysm. Theek hogi baat. Now another situation where the lump is situated in the anterior triangle and showing movements, thyroid or thyroglossal cyst would be the probable cause. Next, if the lump is in the posterior triangle and it is solid and multiple lymph node, that is most probably because of lymph nodes. And if the swelling is cystic, cold abscess, cystic hygroma, or a pharyngeal pouch may also present there in the posterior triangle. Next. So you according to this information, you make a working diagnosis, and specific investigations like FNSE, fine needle aspiration cytology, is a very useful, very cheap, very easily done investigation, and it gives you information which is worthless. In fact, it is very informative, and you can say it is in more than 90% of cases it is correct. And no, not only solids, but cystic swellings can be diagnosed as if you happen to aspirate a swelling which is thyroglossal cyst, there would be colloid material in that cyst. So by aspiration, if the report comes with this colloid material in it, you would be very easily diagnosing that case. There may be a cancer of the thyroglossal cyst also. It is possible. It is very much possible, and we will see in malignant conditions that the carcinomas have been reported in thyroglossal cysts also.
So before FNSE,
yes, that is another way of differentiating between a solid and cystic swellings. Ultrasound of the neck can show differentiate between a solid and cystic swelling. Yes, it will show a lymph in your aspiration from the cystic hygroma, but cystic hygroma is so obvious that a child born with such a huge swelling on side of the neck that he or she looks like a monster, and on palpation you can palpate a ill-defined mass on side of the neck, that can not be anything other than cystic hygroma. So generally few diagnoses are such that you can very easily clinically diagnose. Before going for biopsy, you must get FNSE done of every swelling. Remember, always remember this thing, because with a very simple cheap investigation you can have a lot of information about the swelling. Then you plan the management. Next. Next. So there is another approach in management of those cases. In acute infections, if you see a swelling to be infective in origin, you can treat very easily by prescribing routine antibiotics or painkillers. Next. If you diagnose tuberculosis after investigation, you can very easily treat the patient. Next. Congenital developmental benign conditions are generally treated by surgery. So you educate the patient, and then opinion from ENT people should be sought, and if surgery is required, that would also be done by ENT. Next. Of course, if you suspect there to be a tumor present, you will refer the case to ENT department. Next. Again, if the diagnosis in doubt, kindly refer the case. Next. Lymphadenopathy needs, if you think it is some sort of inflammation, you can give a trial of antibiotics for about 1 week, and then you can send, if not resolved, then send the patient to ENT people. Next. Next. And you can also, where there is a mass and you think further investigations like FNSE or biopsy is required, you can send the patient for a consultation there. Next. Thank you very much. And any questions which